that? Okay, cool.
It's gonna be a long week.
I was about to say, we have the largest attendance ever.
Oh, jeez. We do.
I thought that may not have been a good thing to say. Anyway, so if you want to pan the room, we do actually have the largest attendance for this year. So anyway, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is a regularly scheduled meeting of Sunderland Board of Selectmen. It's January 23rd, 2017. And let's call the order at 6:35. Our first order of business is we have a meeting with the FERCOG transportation people, Beth. And we're going to talk about the Sunderland Complete Streets Prioritization Plan. Beth, what do you want to tell us?
Sure, thank you. My name is Beth Giannini. I work for the Franklin Regional Council of Governments. Presentation, so you won't get sick of listening to me. We have been helping Sunderland to complete a Complete Streets Prioritization Plan, which is a mouthful. It's part of the Massachusetts Complete Streets funding program. It's one of the steps to be eligible to apply for funding for actual projects. So we have a couple of slides just to give a little bit of background on what Complete Streets.
Mark, can you shut off that first row of lights, please? Just the one, the first row. Thank you, Mark. Perfect.
And I'm going to let Jessica McMillan just talk a little bit about the basics of what Complete Streets are, just so that everyone who may be watching or anyone in the audience who doesn't know what they are, they'll have a better sense of that.
Thanks, Beth. So the idea of Complete Streets is that streets should be accessible and safe for people of all ages and abilities and for any mode of transit, so beyond just your individual car that you're driving down the street. So that way people who are walking, people who are biking, people who are taking the bus feel that it's accessible and that they're safe doing so. So there are a lot of ways to sort of conceptualize a complete street. So you're going to see throughout the presentation, the recommendations we make sometimes will be really focused on improving bicycle access. Some of it will be focused on transit, and so we're trying to really make sure that all the different things that we can do, that it's really responding to what the town of Sunderland needs, what makes sense for the use in that area, and thereby making things safer and more accessible. And so there are a lot of real benefits to complete streets, and there's a reason why Massachusetts Department of Transportation has been pushing and has this great funding program. I'm also a public health planner at the FERCOG, and so I think a lot about the connection between built environments and what our infrastructure is like and how it impacts community health. So basically towns that are more walkable, more bikeable, and safer help to reduce incidence of obesity and diabetes, because people are able to live active lifestyles in a safe way. There's also obviously great benefit to making things safer, like adding lighting so that way people feel comfortable walking at night and things like that, as well as some community and economic development benefits around making sure that more people can get to the village center and things like that. So you'll see through these projects all of those things were taken into consideration.
Just to talk just for a minute about the actual program, we're lucky in Massachusetts that we have this Complete Streets funding program, and what it does is it provides funding to towns to it comes through the same steps as the Chapter 90 money. So it basically is like a supplement to the town's Chapter 90 funding to pay for or to encourage towns to do projects that make streets complete. And it provides up to $400,000 a year to towns for these Complete Streets projects. The steps to being eligible to go for that $400,000 is that you have to have adopted a complete streets policy, which I know Sunderland has, and you have to develop a prioritization plan, which is what we're doing, which is basically like a little mini, kind of a little mini master plan for what projects you would use the funding for. The prioritization plan is also sort of intended to kind of just look at the town roads and to come up with that list. There can be things on the list that you ultimately don't go for the complete streets funding. It's supposed to be a very holistic look at complete streets in your town. And part of the program, which was really nice, is that the state does provide funding for the towns to develop the prioritization plan, which I think came in handy for getting it done in a timely and efficient way. So what we've done is we have basically looked at, we didn't just start from scratch. We looked at a lot. There's been a lot of transportation studies and a lot of reports done, some of them really recently. So we took all of that information and we took traffic counts that were completed and any data that we had. We also used, I know the town through the Pathways Committee had actually started to fill out the paperwork and complete the prioritization plan, and there was a really good list. So we really took what you guys had, a great start, and we took that. We combed through reports that were done, we added a little to it, and then met with the Pathways Committee initially and sort of teased out the projects that have ended up in our prioritization plan listing, which is basically an Excel table that has a lot of information, and we have copies of it actually that we can hand around. And one of the requirements for the state doing the prioritization plan is they want you to come up with at least 15 priorities. Which sounded at first, when I started working on it, I thought, wow, that's a lot. But it actually wasn't that difficult to come up with 15. So we initially came up with a list, and then the staff, Lori and Jessica and I, went and visited all of the locations where there were projects. And we did assessments, and we looked around, we took pictures, we did measurements, and we kind of use that site work to refine the recommendations. And then we went back to the Pathways Committee and talked to them again. And basically, the list that you have is the results of both of those meetings with the Pathways Committee and us kind of like refining the recommendations more and also putting them into a prioritized order, which is part of the, obviously part of the prioritization plan. And we're going to talk a little more about the factors that we looked at for prioritizing the projects, but I'll just say simply we started with the list that the Pathways Committee had given us, which I believe was in a bit of a prioritized order. And then I talked to the committee, and we kind of talked through the priorities and what was important. And then based on our site visit, we looked at things like connectivity, safety issues, projects that could happen more easily in some cases than ones that were a little more complicated, and we factored all that in and have the projects in somewhat of a priority right now that we feel is a pretty good list. That's not to say if there's comments or you want to switch the order, we can certainly do that, and we're looking for your input on that aspect. actually, I realized I have this slide here, and I thought it was at the end. So the considerations that we looked at were really safety. Safety always is something that, as transportation planners, we can't help it. Safety is always one of our like top things we look at. Making connections within the town, kind of looking at, like, in some respects, the low-hanging fruit, like which projects are going to give you the best, you know, bang for your buck if going for the funding in the first year. Linkages to destinations, proximity to the village. We also looked around Sunderland Elementary School because it's kind of in a location where there were some projects, and then also just helping to make some connections from the elementary school. Community support, consistency with the Complete Streets program, and then we did factor in engineering costs and challenges. Some of the projects that ended up, we felt like they were more of a challenge, ended up dropping a little down on the list because we didn't want the town to get bogged down with something that had a lot of challenges. The Pathway Committee gave us their goals, and then health equity is something we looked at, and Jessica, as she said, she's one of our public health planners also, and she kind of helped us bring that into the equation. And then environmental justice, which is something that our agency looks at, but all of, basically the whole project area is within an environmental justice area, so that kind of factored in sort of evenly. Let's see. And then I'm going to let Lori talk about the projects, basically.
Okay, yeah. So I wanted to sort of address everything that is included in this list of currently 18 projects without going through each of them in detail. We just want to get quick hits on the type of projects that are included in the list. If you have any specific questions, we can address those as well. But basically, these are the different types of projects. Some of the projects include one or more of these elements, but we're looking at sidewalk improvements, adding new sidewalks to create connections, reconstructing existing sidewalks. We'll have the opportunity to prepare those for a longer service life. Addressing crosswalks, refreshing existing crosswalks, and also creating new ones to provide more safe access. Bicycle access improvements to make a sort of safer, more inviting environment for cyclists, which is a huge part of a growing part of transportation in Franklin County and Sunderland in particular. New curb ramps, those would be ADA accessible wheelchair ramps. You see them, there are a few in town already, sort of with the tactile warning panel,
right,
to alert people that they're about to enter the roadway, and also to provide a sort of a safe transition. Access to transit, and one particular project came up to address pedestrian scale lighting. And in that case, we're talking, well, pedestrian scale, so downward facing lights that still accommodate the dark sky principles, but provide a safer environment for folks walking and in the dark. So the projects that include sidewalk improvements are on South Main Street and River Road. We're talking about adding new sidewalk to connect from Old Amherst Road to the southernmost driveway of the Sugarloaf Estates apartment complex there. There's definitely evidence of folks that are walking towards town from that, so we want to provide a safe path of travel. South Silver Lane, Hadley Road, and Hadley Road, proposing new sidewalks there. On School Street, we are looking at replacing the existing asphalt sidewalk with concrete sidewalk to extend the life of that sidewalk and also to be aesthetically consistent with the concrete sidewalk that is there in sections at North Main Street and in front of the building that we're at now, and then extending further down to the boat ramp that is being redeveloped, I guess, also providing a safe crossing connection there. On Old Amherst Road, we're looking at rehabilitating the existing sidewalk on the north side of Old Amherst Road. I imagine most folks are familiar. There's really not a really good visual aspect to that sidewalk. Like from any angle you look at it, it looks like the sidewalk is part of the shoulder of the road, and that can be dangerous, especially at night for folks walking. And, you know, drivers think they're pulled over in the shoulder, and no, you're in the sidewalk. Rehabilitating the sidewalk at the elementary school, and creating a new sidewalk on North Silver Lane to create a safe walking loop through that area of town from Garage Road all the way back to North Main Street. When we were doing our site visit, when was that, the end of September, like beginning of October, we knew so many people just in the short time we were there that were like, yeah, we're up for our daily walk, and this is the loop we do, and gee, I wish there was a sidewalk here. So that's actually a high priority for a lot of folks. And then we're looking at widening and reconstructing the sidewalk on both sides of South Main Street from Route 116 down to Old Amherst Road. That's been broken up into two separate projects right now, both for cost and also, I know you folks are familiar that there's the another project for resurfacing and reconstructing North Main Street, and that includes a lot of pedestrian improvements, pedestrian and bike access improvements as well. And so we are proposing to address this, the walking path on the west side of South Main Street, hopefully after that project has completed, or at least when that design is finalized, so it's consistent with what's going on in North Main Street. We'll continue on to South Main Street. And Plum Tree Road, we are looking at that up in the length of Plum Tree Road as well. Let's see what else, guys. Next we have some photos here, yeah. So on the left here is River Road, to the end of South Main Street. So this is the section between Old Amherst Road and the apartment complex. And you can tell, I mean, part of that is completely pulling over, but a lot of what's worn away there is because of pedestrians walking on the shoulder. On the right side is South Silver Lane. It's a little shady there, but that is a very wide roadway, and there's, I think, plenty of room there to create a sidewalk on one side of the road. Next, we have the next slide. Hadley Road is shown on the left side. This is a bit narrower, but there's also evidence of a lot of pedestrian activity there, and there's also a lovely farm stand there that providing safe walking access to that would be a great benefit to community health as well. And on the right side is the paved path behind the elementary school. It extends from the elementary school back to South Main Street, technically known as Swampfield Drive. So we're proposing actually pedestrian and bicycle improvements on that. Sort of gets hit in a couple of categories. For this, actually, we're looking at, to jump ahead, but looking at striping this to be more like a bike path, a shared use path with like a thin yellow center line down the middle, and signs on either end that indicate that this is for bicycles and pedestrians and not motorcycles.
Although it is a fire.
It is a fire, and it will still be open for that, but it's okay. Not for a sort of a quick cut through from the school.
Yeah. Question.
As long as it's not about Plum Tree Road, go ahead.
I was going to say, you need to go with Plum Tree very quickly. I don't think, I actually attended a couple of pathways meetings a long time ago. And it's like I've heard this for years, and I'll be dead before the river sidewalks and Plum Tree Road. But it is highly congested.
Yeah.
There's a lot of people walking up and down. There's a business, the book selling business, I can't remember the name of it right now. Mm-hmm. We're getting more and more college kids who are taking over the homes on Plum Tree Road. They get 3, 4, 5 cars. They walk up and down the streets. The other thing I pointed out to the pathway committee a couple of years ago is bike riders don't just go up 47, they go up 116. And what they're doing now in the spring and the summer, of course you don't see it now, is a lot of them are coming down Plum Tree, taking it right up my street. Then they're going up South Silver Lane, which I agree, really needs a sidewalk because people 40, 50 miles.
Oh, yeah. We noticed that.
It's getting more densely populated, I'll say, down in my part of town. They've heard this for 15 years. And I understand the town-village concept, and you want to spread out like a spider, but there's a lot of people down there. There's a lot of walkers, a lot of bikers, and I see the plum tree is number 20 on the list, and I see it's a very expensive project.
It's a very expensive project.
I just think it doesn't, you know, like I said, I'll be dead and there won't be any sidewalks, but I think it should get a little bit higher on the list.
I'd like if we could continue with the presentation. Mark's kind of skipping ahead, and I was serious about the plum tree comment. Mm-hmm. Let them put your presentation together first, Mike, mm-hmm. then we can address
it.
Comments.
So quickly was jumping.
Yeah,
okay.
Here.
Thank you.
Okay, well, so getting back to just going through these in sort of the order that we grouped them in, this part of the presentation is not addressing the priorities, right, but just sort of the different types of improvements that are being put forward in the prioritization plan. It would be new and repainted crosswalks. Crosswalks, especially highly visible crosswalks, are a huge benefit to the safety of pedestrians, especially small children. And
did you look at lighting at the same time?
We looked at lighting specifically on School Street. We did include in estimates and project description some pedestrian level lighting on Old Amherst Road. Yes.
Yeah. Cause I mean specifically about whenever a crosswalk in particular.
Yeah. I brought that up at the meeting.
It did come up at the Pathways Committee, and we can definitely go back and check it out while it's dark. Basically, when we were doing our assessments, it was light out. So we can certainly address that. Do a little survey of which of the places where we're recommending the crosswalks have lighting or maybe need lighting.
Yeah, and again, just it's for us. For us, I just know on crosswalks in particular, and again, we've gone through a lot, like on 116 with the crosswalks.
Yes.
And I was going through there the other night, and it was dark, and we talked about it a lot. I've tested that over the years, mm-hmm. and I still there was something that crossed right in front of me, very difficult to see.
Yeah.
Except they were in dark clothes.
Yep.
Yeah, but I don't think most people, when they get in to go over to the 7-Eleven or wherever, are thinking about dressing up with reflective clothes.
No, they're not.
We're strongly recommending is using the high visibility retro reflective pavement markings. So the markings themselves don't shine a light, but they reflect light back at motorists. So their headlights get reflected right back at them from anything that's painted with this retro reflective pavement markings. They do need to be maintained. They last for a good 5 years in that condition. So that's what we're proposing, to replace the existing crosswalks on Old Amherst Road and South Main Street at River Road, and the new crosswalk that is being proposed on School Street at the boat ramp, which also recommend those high visibility lights, and also the accompanying pedestrian crossing signs, which would also be retro reflective. So at each crosswalk, there'd be signs on either side of the road.
Have you thought about using a stamped asphalt and or a method of, like, if you get to the crosswalk, it's going to, and we don't want rumble strips because of the noise, but mm-hmm. but if you had a stamped area, just something that would be visual, and it would kind of be, you would feel that you're going over those areas as well.
Sorry.
We talked about it in that one of the
We meetings. Did. We talked about it, and one of the issues that comes up with those kind of that stamped kind of treatment is that they're actually really unfriendly to ADA accessibility, particularly wheelchair users or anyone with limited mobility. They can provide a real bumpy surface, mm-hmm. and those folks really, surveys and studies have shown that they're really not recommended, particularly for those users. And one of the things that we're looking at is providing improvements and accommodations that are accessible to all. And the sort of retro-reflective tape markings are really the preferred method. Studies and written reports have shown as far as durability and visibility. So that's what we're recommending. But if you have different priorities, we can.
And again, I'm just trying. Mm-hmm. You know, pedestrian crossing is such a big
contrasting with the rest of the roadway. Yeah.
You know, it. I know, and it's sometimes you can have a sign. The sign's fine.
Yeah.
But I think sometimes it's for a driver. My experience is it's something that they see, if they see it as well. And we're all different learners and respond to different stimulus. But I was just wondering, you know, or make it concrete, you know, across the road. Make it concrete across the road. Something different to designate that area.
Mm-hmm. Something like that could...
I was just going to say that we are... The crosswalk... painted crosswalks, we're also recommending the accompanying, like, signs that... crosswalk signs to go, you know, the whatever the standard is for crosswalk signs to be also be installed. With
in some of the locations, it's also appropriate to install the yield lines. You see them at other crosswalks as triangle lines that point back at the driver, sort of like the, where you would stop or yield to a pedestrian before the crosswalk. So that just sort of extends this sort of crossing area visually. But contrasting materials, those could be difficult to maintain. If you're putting concrete into an asphalt road, they have different responses to weather changes particularly. So concrete's going to heat at different times than the asphalt, and then you end up with grade change, you end up with a bumpy road surface and kind of speed bump. So
I did pick up information that we were at the municipal conference over the weekend, and they had a number of vendors there with like thermoplastic and some of the newer materials that I did pick up information on that. So it looked like it would last quite a while too, because that's a big maintenance is a big issue too.
Or thermoplastic or the epoxy tape.
Yeah.
Epoxy tape, I guess. Has a little bit longer service life.
Yeah.
A little bit easier to install, but I think costs a little bit more. So we went with one of the prioritization plan includes estimated cost for each project, and so we went with a cost estimate that's somewhere in between those two. So we're looking at replacing the existing that sort of hexagon shaped crosswalk that you got there on Old Amherst Road with the continental style crosswalk. It's sort of like the ladder style but without the lines on either side, mostly because it actually I think it's just as visible, but those ladder lines, they get worn away faster than the lines that are parallel to the roadway, so that part will last longer and won't be wasting spending money on something that's going to get worn away real quick.
Yeah, it makes sense.
So after crosswalks, we looked at, so new curb ramps, which you discussed at a few locations, anywhere where there's a new sidewalk or sidewalk transition to a roadway crossing, we're proposing new ADA accessible curb ramps. So those would be on South Main Street and River Road, on Hadley Road, at Old Amherst Road, where we're proposing the new sidewalk. They'll end up Old Amherst Road with a crossing to the opposite side of Old Amherst Road where the existing sidewalk is now. And then ramps on School Street. This is the transition at the end of the sidewalk at the library. So installing a new curb ramp here on either side of the driveway and then to cross the street to the boat ramp. Bicycle improvements. A few different types of bicycle improvements, bike lanes. Is one, a separate bike lane sort of in the existing or new shoulder of the roadway with signs and markings in the pavement that indicate this is a bike lane that's for bikes. Or sharrows on South Main Street. There's not enough room within the road and right of way to create a separate bike lane. Markings in the travel lane that indicate it's a shared use. Motor vehicles and bike lanes are both. And both be using this road and accompanying signs that way. And as I mentioned before, striping a path beyond the elementary school to indicate that it is a bike and pedestrian pathway. On Falls Road, which is very popular and heavily bicycle traveled roadway, adding fog striping, just a white edge line on either side of the roadway there, and repaving Falls Road with a smooth surface. The last time it was resurfaced, it had chip seal, oil, and stone. And that's a durable treatment, but it's not friendly to cyclists. This is an important connection, the Franklin County Bikeway, and really desirable for biking for recreation and for tourism. bike lane on North Main Street, north of Claybrook Road, between Claybrook and Falls Roads. Again, that would require widening, so that's a little further down the list because of cost. The shared use path on South Main Street. What they're looking at now with the North Main Street project is on the west side of the road, a shared use path, which is basically a wider sidewalk. What's proposed now is 8 feet wide, and we're proposing to continue that on South Main Street. I should go back and say when we were talking about the sidewalks, so for the most part, we're recommending 5-foot sidewalks, which is sort of recommended width for ADA and pedestrian accessibility where feasible. And it's feasible on most roadways except in some segments of North Silver Lane where there are some constraints there. And bike lanes on Plum Tree Road, there's plenty of right of way, but not plenty of pavement there. So we accommodate bike lanes on Plum Tree Road, which we do acknowledge is a relatively busy road for bicycles. There's not enough existing pavement there to accommodate a typical travel lane and a safe bike lane, which is about 5 feet, recommended at least 5 feet wide. So that would require road widening. And so that's why it would be a more expensive project. It's about 1.6 miles long. And you'd want to have lanes on either side because bike lanes have the same travel right of way as the rest of the roadways. You're not going two ways in bike lanes, so we require lanes on either side of the road. So that would necessitate some widening there. Lighting, so as you said, we looked at pedestrian level street lighting on School Street, I believe the estimate is to include a pedestrian lighting at a few crosswalks on the Old Elmer Street. That lighting design is not my area of expertise, so I just went with some industry recommendations. You see the cost estimate for the School Street lighting project, I think it's $85,000. That's using sort of the standard, the general cost of about $4,000 per light installed, so not just the light, but the whatever energy pack is required to electrify it, either solar or connecting to an electrical supply, and then the recommended spacing of 50 feet. So if you actually did space them every 50 feet, that adds up to enough that would get you $85,000. So that would, I think, need a little bit of consultation with the lighting expert who could recommend the appropriate spacing for that street, because if you think about that might be a lot of lights for a short segment of road. And then we get into our access to transit project. A covered bus stop in the village with the Pathways Committee, we discussed providing a covered bus stop with a bench on South Main Street at the existing bus stop there, just to provide sort of a safer and more friendly, bus stop for anyone who needs to, wants to take a bus in the rain or before one of the one. It actually provides shade in the summer. It's pretty straightforward there. And bicycle parking rack at the stop on Old Amherst Road. This is a little bit less used stop, but we did notice when we were there, bikes just chained to the bus stop sign. So providing that makes it a little bit more enticing or user-friendly to someone who wants to transfer from their bike to the bus. And providing a safe crossing to the bus stop on Old Amherst Road at the same stop.
There's one more on the access. From North Star, the building that houses the alternate school on 116. Have you looked at that as well? The Pathway Committee may not have looked at it because they may not have considered that, but that's a concern of ours because we have young adults to use that facility and cross the road indiscriminately.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We definitely put that one
up. Definitely. Yeah.
We talked about that a lot.
The issue with that is our focus is on the complete streets prioritization plan. as part of the MassDOT Complete Streets Municipal Complete Streets Program, and that is confined to roadways under the town jurisdiction and not roadways that are under state jurisdiction, which is Route 116. So improvements on Route 116 are definitely recommended and something that should be pursued with MassDOT, but they wouldn't be eligible for this funding program.
It's kind of sometimes dealing with Mass Highways is a circulus project. And I think that's what the director of the North Star has found.
We could probably pursue that with you guys. We can
on
help
separate,
you.
On separately?
Yep, separately.
That's
yeah,
fine. We'll pass that. But could you contact Sherry and Sherry, give her my contacts? I'd like to work with you on that.
Yeah. Yes.
Because that's another place I've seen some young adults just running across us to catch the bus. And I don't blame them because there's no crosswalk there.
Oh,
so.
Yeah. No, that's actually one of the more sort of visible
correct
locations and sort of crying out for.
Thank you.
Complete streets.
Okay.
Is the TIP meeting next week?
Then we have a couple projects that didn't fit into the other categories but are still very important. So we sort of grouped those under village enhancements. Looking at a gateway treatment project on South Main Street and possibly on North Main Street, depending on what shakes out with the design of the North Main Street reconstruction project. Just something sort of in the area of Old Amherst or a little bit further south, sort of indicate that you're entering a village center. The nature of Route 47 changes as you approach the center of town. And so to indicate to drivers, especially those unfamiliar with it, that they're entering a village area and should sort of slow down and be aware that there's a higher density of bicyclists and pedestrians there. So actually for the cost estimate we looked at, and this will be, we looked at possibly like a median island within the middle that sort of you split, just a short one, but to sort of split you around. And also sort of maybe some sort of larger sort of welcome sign. Many of the other improvements that are being proposed in the South Main Street River Road projects, the sharrows and the bike signs, just the presence of those, I think, usually have a traffic calming effect. And I think that combined with like one or two treatments as you enter the village would be a good gateway. And like I said, depending on what is included in the design of the North Main Street reconstruction project, supplementing that with the signs or something. And the two projects that are likely to be eligible for some complete streets funding, but also could be eligible for other funding programs, is improvement to the guardrail on either side of the Slatestrom Brook Bridge and the Chard Pond Bridge on. Yeah, the Chard Pond Bridge on Falls, both of these on Falls Road. They're both in pretty interesting condition, but I know that they're particularly the Slatestone Brook Bridge are popular places for cyclists to sort of stop, take a picture, catch your breath, get a drink of water, look at the falls, and sort of safer and more visually appealing guardrail there would be a benefit. Project specific
stuff. Okay. And the details of all these are in the priority order in the template there. Okay, and then just to kind of finish up, the next steps are for us is to finalize this prioritization plan, which is basically an Excel table. Make sure we have everything in the right order, and finish completing. We need to fill in like construction duration and kind of timing, which we wanted to get any input from the town on that. So at this point, I guess we're asking if you have any comments or anything to change or anything to add. We want to try to get the prioritization finalized. There are a few projects, as Lori mentioned, that are over 400,000 in the prioritization plan, which my understanding, that's totally fine. And I checked with the state, with the program. the projects really are, it's up to us, you know, up to the town, what they want to include. In the cases where the project is over $400,000, we have to list another funding source. So we tried to, we put some funding sources in there, but any other input or thoughts that the town has on those, we would love to get that information or that input from you. Once this is finished, then the town, Sherry, would submit the plan to MassDOT. I believe they review it. I don't think they have to approve it, but they provide comments and review it, I guess. And then the next step in the funding process is to submit an application through this Tier 3 construction. And those are due May 1st. So the timing is actually kind of perfect to get something in for May 1st. And, you know, if there's any help that you need with that, we're happy to help. And then construction, I believe construction, the funding would be for spring, summer 2017.
Okay. Probably what I'd like to do is, if it's okay with the board, I'd like to see if we can get the pathway committee come in and talk to us. Just review the prioritization, mm-hmm. And I will comment to Mark now about where Plum Tree Road is at the present time.
I'm gonna give up on Plum Tree.
No. Well, I think if you look at the list, Mark,
yeah.
if you look at it with a critical eye, you'll find out that most of the items are that are number one and number two are items that can be done relatively quickly and easily. Plum Tree is going to be a little more complicated, but it doesn't mean that it's not on the list. It's not a concern. And as well as a lot of these other things get done first, it'll make Plum Tree more of a priority to tie it in. So your points are well taken. I would say, because where it looks like on a list right now, it's probably not going to stay there. That's all I'm trying to say. Because I agree. We've talked when George first became superintendent, seems like 50 years ago, that was one of the first things that we asked them to look at also. So.
Yeah, and I can say there's sort of two ways to approach Plum Trees Road as far as funding and construction. And what we ended up with was do it all as part of one project, so, you know, so the road's not disturbed, so the residents aren't disturbed multiple times. But that ends up, you end up with a project with a pretty high cost estimate, and to identify additional funding is, as far as I'm aware, the best source of funding for a project of that size would be the MassDOT and the Franklin Regional Transportation Planning Organization's TIP program,
yep.
Which would require engineering design and things like that. And so those things take more time. And so for that reason, I think Beth mentioned that this is a five-year plan. And for that reason, that's why it's toward the end of the five-year plan, so for allow for that.
And I would just, I believe Mark's comments are spot on. Plum, there, if you look at growth in town, it's on the south end of town. And if you go on Plum Tree on any regular basis, you'll find there are a lot of bicycle, there's baby carriage, there's kids, people walking dog. And because it's straight, relatively straight, there's probably a higher speed than... so there's actually it's a perfect complete street program because then you could separate or make safer for pedestrians, cars, the whole everything that complete streets is all about. You could do a project there,
yeah.
That truly is a complete street project. So,
yeah. It's also a major.
It is. Well, that's.
Well, it is between.
That's.
116 and 47.
Right. It's becoming more usable.
Right. But the whole essence of complete streets, Mark, is that you separate pedestrians. Well, no, not that you separate, but you make safe for pedestrians, bicycles, and cars. And no one that I know of wants to hit a pedestrian. And a pedestrian doesn't want to get run over by a bike. So they're all important,
mm-hmm.
components of the, yeah. And that's what Complete Streets was all about.
Yeah.
it wasn't adding about really just adding a stop sign someplace. It was about making the streets safer for everyone.
Constructing bike lanes and narrowing the travel lanes.
Correct.
Almost always leads back to lower vehicles.
Yeah. Bruce?
Did you take into consideration and consult with the police department for past accidents, or pedestrian bicycle accidents in what's locale in town those are happening most frequently?
Lori has, we do have accident data in our office, and we did look at previously completed reports that looked at the accident data, so we did have that kind of information up front. Yeah.
We also had the chief of police walk with us on some of the earlier things that we did. So,
yeah.
Chief Gilbert actually, he was the chief that time, walked with us as we went through all the streets. He was the one that really brought up the North Star even before they moved in, saying that this is going to be a big problem.
Right.
Maybe they should have considered that before they moved in.
Yeah.
I mean, if I'm running a school,
yeah.
I'm going to locate that school in a safe area.
Right.
And you know, yeah. That's a private school, and why should the taxpayers' mm-hmm. money solve their problem? We have a lot of taxpayers on Plumtree Road that are in the same danger.
Right, the 116 is MassDOT.
Right, I realize that.
Unfortunately not, we can't address that. We have to go to
right.
MassDOT to get them to do it.
But still.
Similar to what we had to do with the 7-Eleven.
Right.
Yeah, we did look at crash data, motor vehicle crashes, and also more specifically bike crashes involving bicycles and pedestrians. And apart from the intersection of Route 47 and Route 116, there aren't any real like clusters that come up. There's, you know, an individual crash here or there, and for the most part, those locations to get hit in the projects that are in the prioritization plan.
That kind of leads into a point I was going to bring up too. I think maybe when we have that next meeting, maybe if we, I hate to do it to you, George, but if we like maybe get you and the chief there too, because then you've got all the aspects of, you know, the trend, like the maintenance of it, the safety of it, and then the design, and so we can all get together, you know, not in such a big forum, and just kind of focus on some of those things too. It'd be good. And especially with like Chief Gilbert doing the first one, now we've got a different chief, so he can.
We have a different one, yeah.
Yeah, and you know, so he can kind of give us some input based on what he's seen so far too.
But like ease, like on South Silver Lane or Silver Lane, because there's no such thing as South Silver Lane, according to the town clerk and the fire chief. That's if you look at the width of the road on the north portion of South Silver Lane, that is way much. It's it's like a major throughway.
Yeah.
That could be very, very easily. That could be a highway department project of just, you know, you could put bicycle lane markings and separate a sidewalk there, relatively easy. Because that's who originally built that portion of South Silver Lane was the highway department. So, I mean, we wouldn't have to talk to residents. We wouldn't have to, because everything is already laid out in that area. So it's not trying to get easements or anything. Everything's already defined. So that would be something that we could do pretty easily right up to probably the farmhouse over time. We wouldn't have to do it, you know, we wouldn't have to do everything in 1 year also. We could just maybe 1 year do the striping, next year do another portion of it, so... those are kind of things that we're looking at doing. And again, that would be more low-lying fruit for us to take care of, I would think. All right, so we'll have another meeting with our pathway committee to put the priorities together. We'll get back to you very shortly.
Okay, sounds good.
Okay.
All right, thanks.
Beth
and team, thank you very much. Okay, next is highway department. We'll have our first joint meeting with the finance committee, and we'll look at the fiscal year 18 budget for the highway. We don't think it's storming outside yet, right, George? All right.
Excuse me, Tom.
Yes, it's a good sign.
Tom? Could we take Lauren for the 120 update before the...
Okay.
Lauren,
do you want to do one?
The 120 north.
Want to do the 120? Well, finance committee probably wants to hear this also. Warren, want to give an update on 120?
So now we had a request for proposals for development for the 120 North Main Street site. The bid opening was on Friday the 13th. We had one respondent. It's a proposal from Rural Development Inc. It's actually, they're actually partnering with a bunch of other local agencies. It's a, frankly, an all-local team, including design. The committee reviewed, the 120 North Main Committee reviewed the proposal last Thursday, the 19th, and scored it as quite highly. And we have reviewed a due diligence, so Alyssa from the COG actually ran the reference checks today, and we are taking the schedule and the team next week, if we can make it on the day that we have set aside. And at that point, I think we'd be ready to make a recommendation about.
So you had a meeting. Are you, were you making a gonna make a recommendation tonight?
Not tonight. There's gonna be an interview with the design, with the application team. And we hope by our next meeting we can come back with a recommendation. So references were checked. The committee had, I wouldn't say they were concerns, but questions about a couple of things. Total density, size, and then areas for what were the designers thinking? Get through a little bit of that question and answer before a recommendation can be brought forward.
We also had some questions that we will come up at the interview on that came up as we looked at their budget and some of the other things that we just wanted to get some feedback on. But I think overall we were quite impressed with the submission. So.
Great way to put it.
You might have a
question. Again, you know, if I could, Mr. Chair, a couple of the things that are maybe hardest for the 120 North Main group to work through are the economics, and that very few of us, like none of us, are in the private nonprofit, understanding the administration, the construction, those kinds of elements. How does the economics work out? What's the town's skin in the game, if you will? We already own the property. The request has some opportunity for continued contribution. We need to understand some of those other elements. Pretty straightforward. Again, I think the design and the buildings, the landscape, the Concom piece, the wetlands offsets potential, if they're required, pretty easy to grapple with. But the economics of a multi-agency, multi-discipline, and then administered project, you know, those are likely, certainly where my questions would end up being.
I think Sherry has a copy of, you stole a copy of the proposal.
Yeah.
I looked at, I was.
It's pretty impressive, isn't it?
I thought the breadth of the submittal, the people that were involved was very
right.
Impressive to me. People that have background in this type of work. And I'll use one of Mark's statements. Senior housing has been a long time coming in our town. That's one thing I would have said if you're talking about, let's put it this way, the last time that was any really real senior housing done in our town, or the hope of senior housing, was at our 275th celebration, where they were looking at putting senior housing to the west of the school, or this building, not, well, it's, I still think of the school. That was, I think, the real last, and that was 25 years ago, about. So,
I think, you know, we had a pretty tall order. This is not an easy project. As you know, the land has a lot of, it seems like a big piece of land. A lot of it is wetlands. We ask that the developer keep the house, which is a complication for, honestly, financially and logistically. We asked to keep the building to a certain scale. And it's pretty much, you know, there are some compromises, but in general, they pretty much are a proportionate proposal that meets the general requirements that we asked for. So I think, you know, we're pretty favorably impressed. Hopefully the interview goes well and we can make it help.
Florenger, is your committee's goal to be able to make a recommendation for town meeting springtime?
I think so. I'm not sure that, I don't know that the project requires town meeting approval because you have approval to dispose of the property that we got at the special town meeting. Right. However, there may be a request for additional funds and that may have to go to town meeting.
It'd be a good time to bring it to everyone's a presentation so everybody would know what's going on.
Yeah. I mean, you know, and I think that's important because it is.
Yeah.
Understood. It's not exactly what we had looked at, but it's pretty darn similar.
Okay. Excellent.
So for our next meeting.
We're hoping for this, I think the second?
Yeah, she did confirm.
She confirms?
Okay. So 2-2? For the interview. Got it.
Thank you, Lauren. Excellent. So, Mark, it may look hopeless at times, but there is light.
I can't hear what you're saying.
That's good. But, no, I mean, if you talk to most people about senior housing in a lot of our towns in the area, they would tell you that it's something that's very difficult to bring to fruition, and we may be there shortly. Just like Plum Tree. It may look difficult, but we'll keep packing away at it.
Nora's issue with senior housing, I'll tell you. That wasn't me, but thank you for saying
that. No, I'm saying there's hope. We do have hope.
I have hope.
We do have hope.
Nora's might get done first.
You just got to get creative with the finance.
All right, George. Thank you, Lauren.
A big appreciate that. Start baking cookies.
All right. We are going to talk next with the fight. So who's the chair? Is it Sean? Sean's chair? Mm-hmm. Who's the vice chair?
Who's standing
who's
in?
Vice chair?
Do you guys want to call yourself in order?
Are you in a position to? Ding, 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 ding.
Hello? Yes,
sir. Nice.
Okay.
I was sworn in 2 weeks ago.
Excellent. And your name, please?
Bill Powers.
Nice to meet you.
Bill, it's nice to meet you.
So if you want to...
Well, we don't really need to because we're not going to be voting on anything.
You're not?
No.
Okay.
Copies of the budget are there.
Because I was just telling you, Alex, if you wanted, we could have Sherry do minutes, and she could keep the minutes for you if you wanted. Okay, that's okay. Fine. All right, so let's. We're going to have a presentation by the Highway Department. George, shoot.
So basically, you guys asked for pretty close to a level fund budget again this year. So Highway Garage, Highway Garage Energy combined item. Asking for the same amount, $11,750. Tree warden expense, didn't change any, $7,500 for that one. Highway super wages, that line item will keep blank until we figure out whether we need COLAs or raises of this year. Same with the...
Can you hold on 1 second, George? David, how's the personnel committee looking at that?
We're going to have a scheduled meeting to go over that for this year.
Okay. So. All right, sorry, George.
Probably secretary wages, same scenario on that one. And the labor wages, seasonal wages, I asked for an extra $1,000 to possibly bring in one more summer help kit this summer to help get things moving a little faster this summer. Done a little easier. So I think that extra $1,000 would really help in that department.
What's it equate to for like contact hours, George? 140, 150 hours or 3 hours?
Yeah. Well, if I can divide it up between two of them, usually what I do is I use half of that budget for the rest of, say, like June, July.
Yeah, yeah.
Or May, June, and then the rest will be like July, August. Usually they go back to school in September.
Sure.
So I'm able to split it up enough, I think, to get the two of them in there.
So is it
usually about 25 hours a week or both.
Got it. So as you look at, you know, getting to $5,000, it's important to bear in mind this is part-time seasonal, usually specific to summer, usually young men and women.
College kids usually.
Young men and women between classes.
Yep.
Okay.
Highway labor all the time, that's going to stay the same at $1,561. Highway department expense, I went up $2,000 on that for parts, material, fuel. Our trucks are getting a little older. I guess we're getting a new truck this year, but some of the other trucks are still pretty old. And, you know, it's just for maintenance and stuff like that.
Where are they running the average age now in the fleet, in your fleet?
Yeah,
rolling stock.
2001. Freightliner,
2000
International, the 96 Louisville. The 96 Louisville is the one that's
getting
traded in for the new truck that's coming in.
So we're bringing in a 16, but we also have heavy use on a 2000 and a 2001.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. Sorry.
George, do you have, remember how much was the trade-in value was on the Louisville?
$5,000.
All right. Thank you, George. All set.
And that's about it. Snow and ice wages will stay the same.
It's great.
Is there a reason not to take a look at snow and ice, George? We have gone up a little bit in the past. I see the 17 expense, although down, our base has been creeping up for a couple of years, a couple of budget submissions. Are we seeing pressure on things like sand and salt, and should we prepare for that in this budget, or should we just deficit spend, which frankly I hate, but that's okay.
Right. I wasn't really sure if we wanted to go up on that, because I know we talked about it. I think we've gone up once since I've been here.
Mm-hmm.
Salt right now is down a little bit from last year.
Mm-hmm.
Sand is up a little bit from last year, so...
So as you look at the material expense, it may be the, you know, purchase price or contract price, but there's also a direct component to usage. It's not like you run around at the end of the season and stock the building full of sand and salt based on this year's price. So even if there was a marginal increase in the expense minus the wages, it's just the expense, that could help a really difficult winter in a budget cycle.
Right.
On the deficit spending side, it wasn't that long ago, Mr. Chairman. I don't have to remind you, $104,000, $122,000, $131,000 you have to come up with at special town meeting for deficit spending.
I agree with you, Scott. So, George, I would not that we want to increase budgets, but you know, if we have an opportunity, especially on snow and ice. Materials and wages, we should look at that, because those and Scott's right, it wasn't 4 years, 5 years, 6 years ago. We were writing $100,000 off from our recap sheets on to pay for that stuff. Do you remember last year how much extra that you came for? Like, was it like $15,000 or so, Sherry?
Yeah, it wasn't too bad.
Right, we did that.
Yeah, and again, I just think that, you know, if we get, I know why we haven't budgeted those numbers at what they are, because that's the one area that we're allowed not to, you know, we're allowed to deficit spend. But if we could bump up the numbers a little bit on that, that may be appropriate.
All right. Right now we're at snow and ice wages. We spent about $5,800. Highway department or highway snow and ice expense. It's right around $18,700.
Yep.
We've spent so far this year.
So there's risk to, again, to deficit spend, which completely appreciate the tool, I really do, but budgeting just to deficit spend, and I have strong feelings about
it. Okay. Have you, George, last year you bought the whacker, the to do sidewalks and stuff?
Yep.
Have you found that to be advantageous to have that piece of equipment?
Yes, it's come in handy a lot more than, I've used that thing more than I've used that whacker in the 7 years I've been here.
The holder?
The holder, yes. Hmm. It's very handy. Good. It comes in, you know, it's great.
So when we had people here earlier talking about sidewalks and the maintenance, what's your thoughts about that as well? Because, I mean, we still take care of the sidewalks and Sunderland. What are your thoughts?
We take care of about 4 miles right now, and it takes, depending on what piece of, I mean, if we use the plow, it takes us about 2 hours. If we use the snowblower, it takes us about 4.5 to 5.
Okay.
Just for the sidewalks we have now. So if we add, I mean, if we keep adding sidewalks, it's going to take us a lot longer.
It's almost an hour a mile for a storm, per storm?
Yeah.
And
the
that's
sidewalks that they're in the shape they are now, we can't go very fast on.
Right.
Yeah, and that was a topic. I tried to represent you as the proxy for like highway maintenance and stuff there too. And that was one of the things we talked about, was plowing it. And then, you know, where do we draw the line and say, okay, you know, you're responsible for the sidewalks, and which ones do we plow, which ones do we don't? So we definitely talked about that.
We spent 2 days this summer patching.
Yeah.
I think North and South Main Street are difficult because of the tree roots. I'm still very interested in how they're going to overcome that with the North. I just know in my job, whenever I get within the what they call the tree line of a tree, there's a major, you majorly upset the tree's viability. So, I mean, that's what we're going to be doing the whole up and down North Main Street. So I'm very curious to see how they're going to address that.
I think the only way I can see it is that they move it towards the road more, because there's really no room between property and trees.
Right. I agree.
And one of these proposals has got it that way. It's between the roads and the trees. Yeah. But to Tom's point, you get inside the canopy, you know, all bets are off. The canopy roots are usually a third thereof. If you get to a canopy and you go, well, okay, half the times the canopies are out over the road, what do you do? Mm-hmm.
Well, it's interesting, but you know, the new trees that we're planting, if the new trees go in and those areas are all asphalt, they will grow around the asphalt. It's pretty amazing. They won't because there's no water, so everything goes away from the asphalt. I just put in a steam line last year, and we had to go between two trees. Mm-hmm. And we were very worried with the shade tree committee.
Sure.
But where we dug, because there had been a pre-existing sidewalk there for...
Was not a root stock.
There was absolutely nothing there.
Isn't that interesting?
And believe it or not, the most prevalent roots that take are usually within the first 18 inches of the soil.
Right.
So, on most of those trees. But George, so the whacker has been advantaged to you? And okay, on a job like when I was talking earlier about like on South Silver Lane, is that something you guys think that you could do, George?
It's possible. I mean, the only thing I really would have a problem with, if we narrow the road up, the drainage is right on the very edge of each road, so that's where all the catch basins are. So if we narrow one side up, we're going to have to try to figure out whether we're going to have to move all those catch basins into the road more.
Yeah, it begs a review of the shared use path, not unlike they're talking about on the west side of North Main. I think the design is going to be really important.
Rather than just cutting into the...
You know, a couple of crosswalks is one thing to get across toward the shared use path. But again, it was personally speaking, it was very enlightening after the give and take on the North Main project, the requirements from Mass DOT for standard design, you know, even in the recommendation of this group here for complete streets, they say it's a 50 foot taking, you got 22 feet of road. Do you want to see it just more and more pavement? Probably not likely. Mark, they won't slow down if it's wider.
No.
You know, the question is how do you go about that? So it was very enlightening to see how that plays out. And again, a designer will be a sound design will be an important piece to any of projects like that success.
Mm. George, I notice a lot of towns now are just going pure salt.
Yes. I was going to talk to you guys about that.
What's that?
I was going to talk to you guys about that eventually, whether we want to try that or.
What do you think?
Some parts of me say yeah, and some parts of me say no. I'm not 100% sold on it, I guess, yet. Salt's very tricky sometimes. I mean, you have to stay on top of and keep that brine going, because if you don't, then things freeze back up quicker. Yeah. And sometimes when you have that sand, you get a little bit of mealiness out of that stuff. It keeps it kind
get
of
a little traction.
So it's hard to say.
I know, this morning there was state trucks out sanding or salting at
straight salt.
Like yeah. Quarter to six this morning.
That doesn't make sense to me.
And I noticed, like, sometimes I see Hadley's got salt on the roads hours before the storm.
Yeah. Coming an hour or so before the storm, if you can, is perfect. So it doesn't blow up and they crush it into the road. But like your high traveled roads, tends to blow off to the sides a lot of times, I think.
What do you use for a mix now?
We are a little bit higher than 50-50. I think we're about 60-40, maybe 65-35.
Okay.
We're mixing it a little bit more salt than we are sand. So.
So is there a savings later on with the road sweepings?
Last year, we had a few savings last year. We didn't sweep as many days as we did the year before.
I just wonder if...
That could be because we didn't have the winter either, too.
Yeah, not as much time.
These storms that we're getting tonight, we use a lot more material than we do in a big storm.
Right.
You just blot it out.
The one we just had, right?
We used a lot of material now and just try to keep everything loose because it kept hardening up and packing down quicker. So we got to spread it up a couple more times than we usually do.
Okay. Bruce?
What about the liquid stuff that they use? I know like Amherst uses liquid. You go up to Vermont, they're always putting the liquid down.
There's several different kinds of stuff. There's ice band, ice be gone. There's calcium. I know a lot of guys are using like a molasses brine or something now. Stuff like that.
Cheaper, more expensive than salt? Better for the environment than salt? What's the difference? What's the advantages?
Most of it's around the same price, maybe a little more expensive than the salt is per gallon. I mean, you have to buy all the spray equipment to put on your trucks and the tank in your shop and stuff like that. Some of it is mixed on the salt now. A lot of towns are going to a treated salt, which is treated with that kind of stuff.
Is that like the green salt you see?
Yeah, that's the green salt. There's copper, blue. There's a couple different colors and stuff. Okay. Like the treated salt that we buy is a blue color from American Rock Salt. Yeah. It's treated with like a calcium chloride or a mag chloride or something like that. It works at a colder temperature. I think Hadley spreads.
Yeah,
I see that.
Amherst,
I see Hadley.
Yeah, UMass uses the snow be gone, but they mix it with they apply it to the salt.
Yeah. I know Kevin over in North or Deerfield was talking to me about some kind of a spray doing it. Maybe like a couple towns were in on that, but he was doing some more research on it, so I could more about that to find out what he was thinking about it.
How'd your bucket truck thing work out okay this year?
It's good.
So we went in with three towns, right?
Three towns.
Sunderland, did you know about that finance committee?
Yeah, we talked about it last year.
Yeah. So we went in with Sunderland, Deerfield, and Whately.
Yeah.
And
really well.
So we get to use it, they get to use it.
Yeah.
Who was the lead on that? Were we had the lead on
that? Deerfield has it right now. maintenance, what's out of the weather.
And they do the maintenance on it?
We all do. I mean, if we have it, we'll do the maintenance. If Waitley has it, if something needs to be done, we'll do the maintenance. Same with Deerfield.
Okay.
So we all share, basically, we all share all the costs, so it's not like one town's taking the brunt of everything, so.
Good. So you're happy with that?
Yeah.
All right, good.
Does that require hoisting licenses to operate?
It doesn't.
It doesn't?
No.
What's mileage on the trucks?
On our trucks?
Yeah.
I really couldn't tell you that offhand. Mileage usually is not, we don't put a lot of miles on those trucks.
Turns back
into
hours.
I want to say probably, yeah, a lot of more hours than miles. I think right now most of our trucks are around 45,000, maybe 50,000. Now the pickup truck has, that gets used a lot, so that pickup truck has probably 130, and that's an old 3. The loader has, I think, 6,800 hours on it, 6,500 hours on it now.
That had a rebuilt one in a couple of
transmission. Transmission. I think it was 22,000 and some change. Right now, it's still running pretty good, so
I'm not going to run out. Any more questions on the budget before we go into the capital? What's that? Okay, capital.
Capital stuff, I just got a couple phone calls back for quotes. One of them was Sunderland Town Hall, and the other one was the mower. So right now, the two holders that we have, one of them has the mower on it, and that one's a little pretty fire. We're starting to have problems with the clutch on those. And to put a new clutch in one of those things is probably $5,000 to $6,000. And personally, I don't think it's worth it to put a clutch in, because one's at 85 and I think one's at 87. Hmm.
So you're going to use the you're going to use the whacker for the mowing?
I don't know if they make a mower attachment for that, and it might be a little bit heavy to run across the ground, so I was thinking about maybe purchasing just a zero turn mower, a small one, mm-hmm. just to do the mowing that we do.
What's the reach of the mowing, George?
What do you mean?
How much do you do?
How much do we do? We do probably, there's probably almost 2 acres at the shop that we mow.
That's the only mowing you do?
Right.
Right around the garage?
Around the shop, yeah. With the holder, when we mow with the holder, it takes probably close to 2 hours, 2.5 hours, I think, mowing. We mow behind the fire station, around by the sewer, in front of the sewer there, behind the sewer, down by where we keep out gravel and stuff like that, we mow all that along the side of the garage.
Speaking about behind the sewer, the stuff back there, do you think we could get a junker in to maybe come back and tote a lot of that stuff out?
Yeah, I've been waiting for a price to try to go up because it ain't worth putting it in a truck right now. I returned some stuff earlier in the spring and we had a whole 1-ton load and I think we got $37 for it, so it wasn't even worth the time loading it.
George, you can't even buy coffee for $37.
Exactly, so that's why it's been sitting there still.
Okay.
So I estimated a mower out at around a high estimate about $13,000. They're coming in around $10,000.
Yep.
$400, something like that, $10,400. So I estimated around $13,000. And that's right now I got one quote on a Skag mower, 61-inch. That thing would probably last us 20 years or that.
So it begs the question, if I could, Mr. Chair, if you have an increase in seasonal labor and a new mower, are there any other areas we could take a look at? We currently contract the town out town-wide.
Yep.
You could probably take over a few things, but if you're going to take over everything.
Nope, I didn't say everything.
Right, no, I understand, sure. But you could probably add on a couple things and take some things away.
Again, we're in a contract, I think there's the second year of 3 right now,
yep.
So if we're going to have a piece of capital like that, and add seasonal hours, mm-hmm. to me, it's worth the conversation,
right.
as this all unfolds.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
what's the contract? $10,000 a year? What, is that what we're paying for the mowing now?
It's like $10,000 over three.
$10,000 per year?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And how many acres are they doing? Probably going 15 acres?
Yeah, they do the school, they do the roads, they do the cemeteries, they do all of it.
Throw that in with a garage and save the money out of capital. I mean, that's...
I mean,
the mowing contract's the best thing.
That's a great deal.
Mm-hmm.
It has been.
They mow at the garage. They do mow at the garage. They mow the front lawn. Yep. That's it.
Hmm. Well, they've been very good. We've extended some of the areas down the cemetery. We know those areas, and we've come back and they've adjusted accordingly. So maybe it's worth a conversation.
And then you guys saved your guys new other stuff.
Yep.
You can get a 21-inch push behind. I'll even give it to you.
You volunteered to shoot.
Recreation has asked for additional noise to the field, so that's something that we could.
That comes up every
absolutely
year.
Right.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yep.
Yes. Okay. Good point, Scotty. Anything else, George?
Next one is the office heater.
Yep.
We put one here in last year in the break room area. My office has an old, they call it an old camper heater.
Yeah, direct fire through the wall, gas hot air furnace.
Gas hot air, and it constantly stinks.
So,
Scott, is that something you could put a split in?
We did that in the other office. Sherry, is there any reason that's not a classic Green Communities money?
We were talking about putting that under Green Communities, so I didn't know, so I just put it under here just in case.
Yeah.
Because then it's all.
What kind of price you got for that?
Four.
Because then it's all electric and they get the solar.
Well, I mean, a split would be considered energy efficient, right?
Mm-hmm. Looking at it right here.
Yeah.
Sherry, can you look at that with George? Look
at $2,400. That's for the installation and not the wire.
Right. Is that for a split?
Yeah, that's for a mini split.
For $3,200?
Mm-hmm.
Can you look at that?
Install and then I'll have to
get the wire. I know if you do an energy audit on your house, they're going to tell you they'll...
We just, last week, they came in and they did energy audits of the mechanical on all the town buildings, so we should have the reports.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What's that, Bill?
I'd get prices on that.
There's
the change in the design, yeah, as opposed to a through-the-wall propane hot air furnace.
Just under $3,500.
Right.
$3,500?
Last year.
And how many square feet they doing?
That's just two rooms in that space right now.
So that's what, maybe 100 square feet?
Yeah.
Yeah, probably. And they're a small unit out there, they're about 1 pound
each. Okay, next.
I was thinking about trying to put a two-post vehicle lift in.
You put it in the highway in the highway garage itself?
Yep. It's a 15-ton lift.
If you did that, would you be doing the police cruisers also?
Yeah.
So what's the challenge with the disposal of waste oils?
And what's right now I put it in a barrel and I bring it to a couple garages that have waste oil burners.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. As a municipality, and Tom, you know where I'm going with this, is there any kind of legacy costs associated with that over a certain volume?
For oil? Waste
yep.
oil?
Yep.
I don't believe so.
Okay.
I just have to have a sign something.
Oh, what the heck is that term? There is a term for that, Scott. You're right.
Right. There's a tipping point where, you know, a variety of products you can do as a waste stream for, and there's a waste stream management. You can walk in with, you know, 4,500 light bulbs. Whoa, stop. What does that mean? So,
okay.
Right now, we probably get maybe a barrel a year.
Mm-hmm.
At the most, so that's
cost to look?
It's about $8,500.
Okay, what else you got, George? I see you got storm drain repairs.
Storm drain repairs, we have this on, I don't know if it was a capital improvement, but when Margaret was here, we put it in. Mm-hmm. We've been there several times, so mm-hmm. I couldn't remember what we put it under, so I put it under the capital.
Capital, yep.
Basically, what this is for is to go around and replace storm drains, catch basin repairs, and mm-hmm. stuff like that, extra mm-hmm. from our budget that we have.
Did you do them last year?
Last year we did, we still have a few $1,000 left in that. $7,000 left in that, out of $20,000. So we did, I think, six basins last year.
So if I could, Mr. Chair,
two.
The question about an inventory and their time, George. So we know where we, even if it's something as simple as a spreadsheet that says, you know,
where they were.
Right where they were, you repaired what the repair was. You
know, well, actually, Scott, if I could, I think we're going to be required sometime soon, if not already, to document how often that we clean them and how much stuff we're taking out of them and all that good stuff.
Yeah, I'm thinking
bad
about
stuff.
Asset management, that's all.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I know that's what we're working on right now, mm-hmm. is identifying where they are and what we're doing for maintenance on them.
I was talking to a gentleman yesterday that it might be doing some GIS stuff for the water department.
Yeah.
And he was saying that that he would include our, because I was talking about our catch basins.
Our catch basins.
Mm-hmm. Stuff like that. He said he would include that into it. You know, he'd talk to Freddie about it and talk to us about it and maybe include that all together and mapping it all out for us.
He could roll it up. He could roll that up into one project split between the two entities.
Yeah, you know, like that way everything will be mapped out, and I know, and then I can just go on that and just, you know, label that on that map what we replaced and what mm-hmm. we haven't.
Yeah,
what needs to be replaced.
Mm-hmm. That's
a cross reference.
George, I think the catch basins are fine. We need to do those. So, if you let us know how many you want, you know, how many you want to do. You could be a little more specific on that, if you would, please. Okay.
You don't have a number of that yet?
Not right offhand. Okay. Usually when we'll clean the basins out, the guys will inspect them and then they'll let me know what basins need really need attention and what don't.
All right, George, I'm going to ask you something that you don't have to answer. You heard what just happened in Florida. Three guys went down into a catch basin. No one came out.
I went down one at a time.
So I would say I don't know if you have a and Sherry, I don't know if you have a confined space
gas
program.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you have gas meters yet. I guess I should, but that should be on your list. Okay, and you can get a Draco, which is a 4 gas. For $2,300. That's what Con Ed ordered, 2,500 of them. So I said, if it's good enough for Con Ed, it's probably good enough for us. So I think that's something that you should have. Would you please?
Yeah.
I mean, and just so you guys are safe as well.
Yeah, can't they visually inspect those or fly
stuff? That's what I
usually
do.
I mean, yeah.
I usually pull the cover off and I just kind of stick my
head. Yeah, I mean, I visually inspect to see what's going on there and everything.
Most of our basins here are 6 to 10 feet, 12 feet. Some of them are a little bit deeper than that, but they're not that deep.
Sure.
We can work on that, George, okay?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Definitely. Maya does confined space training too, so
yeah, they have them in the office either.
Can you remind me of that?
Sure.
Because that is important.
And last thing is our fuel dispenser replacement. Right now, the fuel system works fine. But in the summertime, when it gets hot, muggy, and sticky out, it won't pump gas. It takes 4 or 5 times to get the gas to start pumping. Sometimes it won't even pump until it gets cold.
I got a question, George. I got a question, and I don't know the answer. I know when we had more volatile fuel prices, sometimes we get locked into a contract that's making us pay $3 a gallon when we could buy it at the local place for a buck and a half.
Right.
Are we better off having something like this, or is it better just to go on a, like a credit card and or a fuel card of some sort?
In some aspects, it's a lot easier sometimes just to have the fuel card. But for us, it's nice to have all those pumps right there. Just, you know, when we're plowing and stuff, we start running out, go fill up and keep going.
So right now you have fuel, you have diesel and gas?
Again, based on the way futures are going right now, that's going to help you when the price goes up. It's when you get hosed when it's going down. And right now, there's been a lot of meetings with OPEC, and they're cutting back production. So it looks like we're going on an upswing.
This year, our price isn't too bad. Last year, we kind of got hosed
over. Okay. All right. Bruce?
I think that's something to look into.
Well, I'm just
go along with that facility and everything else, and if you know you get a spill there or something
on-site
else,
storage, yeah,
then it's a whole
right.
different ballgame.
Yeah.
And you know the part of the issue with using a vendor is you know you'd have to make arrangements with someone in town or close by, because when you come to diesel, I think the closest place is probably Carriage Oil.
Carriage and Trust Oil.
Yeah, and. You know, for gas, you only have one option in town.
Now. Yeah, now. Well, you could. I mean, or you could just go across the river.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. But I mean,
you know. And you got the two different places. It's convenient to have it there. I don't know how you ever get.
I mean, that facility was, what, about $50,000 to $60,000 to put in?
Yeah, at the time, I'm sure.
It's
yeah.
an expensive facility.
I got a price to replace that pump and stuff. It's $4,356.
Just for the pump.
The pump and the
control mechanism.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're thinking about the tanks and all the potential issues with it and everything.
The tanks are in great shape. They're in a concealed.
Yeah, they're in a confined yeah. space and everything else. I know that, but you know, I think there's something to look at. You know, $4,300 ain't bad just to replace the pump.
Right.
You know? Because it is a big convenience.
No, I'm just thinking it gives us, you know, it gives us that option. But if you think about it, you spend $50,000. That's a lot of gallons of gas.
It is. Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, if you're paying, you pay a dollar more a gallon. I don't know if we go through 50,000 gallons.
Those pumps have a register on how many gallons they're pumped in there. That's quite a bit.
I'm sure it is, but I was just.
That's gonna be what, 20 years old?
Probably. I mean, I still have all the original paperwork in the shop.
Yeah, it's all that. George Buzzala put all that in. That's all.
Yeah.
That's pretty old.
The pumps that are on there, they're telling me that these are like the old farmer style pumps. They're
They wore out. They never wear out.
so yeah, and
diesel pump.
Yeah, right.
But maybe we should have both options, Bruce. You could, and again, I look at diesel. I know one advantage that we had over a lot of towns when we had the last power outage, that October snowstorm, we had surrounding communities coming to us to get fuel because they had no way to get fuel because everybody had no power. We had a generator.
Well, opportunity pricing, Bruce. Opportunity pricing.
We didn't want to get in trouble with the federal. We didn't want to violate the gouging rules, Bruce. But
I mean, for the police department, it might be a good thing to have credit cards for them because they go through a lot of gas. So when the price does come up,
they have been hit before. Yeah.
Well, we haven't looked at that in a while.
Yeah.
But then I was just reading about there was one community. And I don't think it was too far from us where they found one of the highway guy came in and noticed a police with his local car.
I'll fill it up.
And the guy was filling up his personal car.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right.
This controls for that.
Well, now there's this big investigation. Well, he's no longer working there, but there's a big investigation. It was thousands of gallons.
The system we have now, there's specific cards for specific cars.
Yeah.
and they have to punch in a certain code, their code, personal code.
Yeah.
And it comes right to my computer, and it's all documented.
Yep. All right.
But still, they can go there. Someone can go there with their own car, with a card and everything else, and fill it up. So,
yeah.
Do you have cameras there?
There is none.
You can always override a system and hack it.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Does George, you may have a long night. Does anybody else have any questions for George?
All right, so you'll get back to us to talk about storm drain inventory and kind of strategy, right, George?
Yep.
And then mini splits. And then we're going to talk one more time about mowing and what it could mean to expand if we're going to pay, if our town's position is to take and spend capital money. Is there an additional area we can pick up with the mowing? Or do we spend the capital money and simply add it to the existing mowing contract?
Okay. Thank you, George.
Thanks so much, George.
I guess we're all set with the budget portion of the... Do you have any more budget to talk about, Sherry?
No.
All right. Scott, you all set?
I'm all set.
David, you all set?
I'm good.
All righty. Moving on. All righty. Next up... minutes of the January 9th.
Make a motion on those.
We have a motion.
I would just add, if I could, on an executive session, the minutes show that we did in fact go into executive session under Chapter 38. If I could amend the minutes to just say that our only discussion was about the pending police contract.
Hmm.
Yeah. We were pretty clear about it in our open session. The only reason we went there was an update.
Right.
There's nothing nothing cantankerous, nothing else.
Yeah. Right. So I announced that we were reconvening an open session.
But up here it says we're only going in if it litigating position of the public body.
I just took it the way it was read off the
Right off from 2.1.
Yeah.
No, I understand. I'd just like to add the subject. The only reason we went there was
what you were talking about.
An update for the police contract. That was all.
That makes sense.
Someone in the future reads this, like, well, for what?
Yeah, right. You win based on the chapter, but okay, right. What were you talking about?
Right.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Again, it was just a police contract update. Really simple.
Okay.
Police negotiations update, excuse me, if I could modify that.
It's getting icy out, so watch yourself going out.
Oh, is it?
Thank you, Bruce.
Thanks.
Thank you, Bruce.
Outside of that modification, Mr. Chair, approve them.
Okay, motion made and seconded with correction. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
3-0. Next up, the Board of Selectmen updates. David?
We talked about complete streets, so that was my big thing. And then we're going to schedule our personnel committee meeting to start rolling into that fund for our COLAs and everything. And that's about it, other than our fabulous conference that we had, which was good.
Okay. Scott?
Mr. Chair, the 120 North Main, as was mentioned tonight, is moving forward, and we hope to have a recommendation for the board at our next meeting. Again, the interview is the only issue. All of the evaluation forms were sent in, and we did get, as Lauren said, one bidder, one really qualified team. So we were hoping to get through one more conversation with that team, ask a couple of what we think are pertinent questions, and then bring a recommendation to the board for progress.
Good. I'm all set. Sherry?
I'm all set.
RAO appointments?
Move the slate as presented. We have a big highlighted list.
I went to the conference in Boston about this. I don't know if this is the way that's recommended for every town. I understand why they do it. There was people in the meeting that wanted to ensure that the clerk didn't have access to, shouldn't be going through their stuff, and I kind of disagree with that. But the only thing that's we have to, as a town, develop some type of either an Excel spreadsheet or some way of logging all of the requests for public records, So that has to happen.
I did make an Excel spreadsheet and sent it around to everyone, and then Copeland and Page sent one today from one of the presentations at the conference.
Oh, nice.
So we're on our way. We're reviewing policies. Hadley just adopted a policy. We're looking at what's going on out there and what.
Well, why it's important, okay? This is, and I, Lauren Goldberg from KP Law, and this was one of my concerns, is that on this, we're making the chair and the clerk of each of the committees RAOs. Mm-hmm. And so the Board of Assessors gets a request for a public record. Well, and I'm just picking on the assessors right now. It doesn't have to be the assessor. It could be any group. But so the request goes to the chair or the vice or the clerk. They don't act on it. They may not know the rules. They just let it sit. And it goes past the 10 days. We didn't request an extension. We don't know there was a request made. So the person that did it hires an attorney. Most attorneys in Boston, they get $400, $500, $600 an hour. They put 10 hours into finding the information or filing a claim against the town of Sunderland. Now we're faced with a $5,000 or $6,000 bill that the keeper of the records will enforce upon us, and the Board of Selectmen, town administrator, no one knew about it.
Yeah, one of the things I thought about for that is, instead of like an Excel, maybe looking at a Google sheet, because then everybody in the town, you work on one shared sheet, everybody's got access to it at the same time. So that way, if like the Board of Assessors puts it out there, you're going to see it. And not only that, you can actually see when they're logged into it, and you can see them moving around.
There's
and stuff.
Software out there. I was looking at it. It's pricey.
Yeah, but yeah, that's the
It is pricey, but. But what
public price list too, right?
what they recommended though is that we have to have the RAOs listed on the webpage. Mm-hmm. And
yep. Okay.
And they recommended that you keep all the requests on the webpage also, so anybody can look at any time.
And you can put a link to whatever we're tracking.
So maybe David, maybe you can work with Sherry and Wendy to make this happen. But okay. But again, you know, a request goes into the school committee. And again, I have no idea when they, and when you, we know the law that you have 10 business days.
Patty Kavanaugh's been appointed the REO for the school, so okay. I'll make sure that's listed on our website.
Okay.
Yeah, and the nice thing I was just thinking, if you work off a shared sheet too, you can send a link to like the school committee members and give them, you know, whether it's read-only access or, you know, read-write access, mm-hmm. So we can kind of keep it all and then
centralize it.
And if, you know, if you're like the, you know, the REO overlord, you know what I mean? Right, you get to, I still wonder how you get a cape with that, you know? You get to keep an eye on it so you can see what's going on, and it tracks everything that gets done. So if somebody accidentally, you know, did something, you can see, and you can, and this, you can go back to previous versions. So if something got hosed accidentally, you can say, oh, let's go back to this version.
And again, I think this is much more complicated than what as presented, or it could be. And by having a lot of RAOs, I don't know if it's making it better. And again, you know, the redactions, you know, how to redact, when to redact, how to look up the information. I think it's a little more complicated, but. Let's not lose sight of that, okay? So we have a motion to appoint as presented the list of our RAOs. Do you second that, David?
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 I'm going to say no just because I have a concern. I want to watch this.
Yeah, it's good.
So I'm going to say 2-1. I think we are going to have to watch this.
I could, Mr. Chair, just to tie in. Even though we have an appointment for the current year, right? We meet the current requirement of the statute while we develop the actual kind of master planning of that between now and the reappointment schedule, which is only a few months away.
And you know, it's unfortunate, but we go to Boston, I mean, the thing, And the first thing the panelists are talking about is that they're talking about writing corrections to the new law.
Yeah.
And it's, and it's like, oh my gosh, they just made the law.
We just did this,
so.
Exactly.
Okay, next up is a DLTA ranking. Do you want to do that this tonight or you want to do that next week?
It was due on the 19th.
So under the planning projects, you know, we're one through five here.
Yep.
Do we want to have consensus, or do you want to send in our individuals and have Sherry come to a means in our scoring?
I just submit them. I just submitted to Sherry.
Okay.
All right. And she can tally them up.
Got it.
All right.
The only thing I'm stuck at right here is community compact projects, and I think there's a couple in here. If I could, Mr. Chair, very briefly, under housing and economic development, some of these areas we have already been at, like the housing master plan or zoning bylaws or et cetera, and I think the ranking is going to be important. But under the community compacts, because this is new, this is the second full year, the ranking, I don't struggle with, but it says identify each best practice. If I could ask that we rank based on our priorities, and then the best practice is an extension of the community compact. It's not what we do.
Yeah.
I did talk to Sean Cronin at the conference about
Thank you.
That. And he said that we'll be eligible to reapply for fiscal year
Good.
18.
Good.
So that'll roll out in May and start
okay.
in July. So we could pick a few more.
Brilliant. I say that again, Mr. Chair, if I could, only in that the practices themselves, they're only now being rolled out. The compacts have been established, and the practices haven't necessarily been communicated across. So I think the ranking is important.
Okay. We need to vote to
submit a local technical assistance form to Sherry where she can aggregate our scores.
Yep.
Second.
And submit accordingly.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
3-0. Appointment of temporary laborers Edward and Robert Skowitzki.
So moved.
Motion.
So moved.
Yeah, do you want to read it or are you good?
Oh yeah, okay.
Just take a second. This is to the Board of Selectmen, dated 1/17/17. Please accept my recommendation to appoint Edward Skowitzki and Robert Skowitzki to the position of temporary labor for the Sunderland Highway Department. The rate of pay for both will be $18.34. Thank you, George Henry, Highway Superintendent.
Motion.
Motion.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Next Selectman's meeting is next Monday. We're back to once a week.
I was going to say, we're back to once a month? When did we start that?
Okay. Sherry, let's do once a week from now on. So, okay. Motion to adjourn.
If I could, Sherry, Mr. Chair, Sherry, the community development strategy.
Oh, yeah, you need to vote to adopt that for the grant application.
Got a motion on that one?
Again, I think this is something that if we can get in the form, we have a draft in front of us. Only a couple of pieces here are ongoing, but most of it looks like it's ranked pretty well.
So you want a motion there?
Move to submit.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
3-0. How's that? Anything else?
That's all, Mr. Chair.
I have one thing.
Shoot, Sherry.
I got a call tonight just before the meeting. An electrical contractor who's doing an energy project at Cliffside, the permit application, she said was $4,000, and she was wondering if the board would consider reducing that fee because it is an energy project. I guess other communities, I'm told, have done that. What it's an energy-related project. So I told her I would check with the board.
Is it in a public building?
Cliffside Apartments.
So the answer is no?
Yes.
Okay.
I would say that I would check with the electrical inspector, but I think the electrical inspector, I think, gave them an option that they chose not to take.
Okay.
I think. So maybe we should let the electrical inspector know. But the other thing is, I don't know if we have a mechanism for doing that.
We can set the rates, but there's no abatement function. Something that it does do, Mr. Chair, if I could, is illustrate a unit per unit or task per task fee versus in some communities that have adopted a multi-unit fee. Instead of it being an individual appliance, do it by a percentage of the total project cost.
Correct.
The city of Chelsea does a very good job with that.
I think they were given an option.
Okay.
I think. Okay. Anything else?
That's all.
Motion?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0. Sherry, please call us out at 8:25.